see everyone this morning. Welcome to our Sunday morning service. One of the things we like to do is start out with a hymn song. You can either follow along on the video screen or you can look it up in our blue hymnal, but we're going to start out with the Family of God, page number 23 in the blue hymnal. Family of God, number
seek the mind of God and to find that you already had a solution. It is amazing to me when people, all of us, are on a journey, and when someone needs a church and someone else has a facility, and we just decide to, as Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, to share what we have because it really all belongs to you. You're the Lord. You're the owner of everything. So today we come together, we want to say thank you for the members of Living Hope who were fulfilling your instruction to us to have hospitality, and for the members in Parkway Baptist Church who have strived and worked for the gospel for years and sacrificed and made it possible that we could have two churches committed to the Great Commission of Jesus Christ, working together, loving the Word of God, loving the Lord Jesus Christ, and loving one another. It is wonderful to be here today with you, Lord. Now I pray that as we go forward in our worship service and during the baptism, all these things, we just be amazed that you're here with us today. We're not alone. Thank you for being here with us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Madison is 10 years old, been a part of our church, his family has for many years now. And Alvin, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Upon your public profession of faith in Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Jesus said in his name, God has commanded, and yet there is room. Congratulations, Alvin. Go ahead. And just a wonderful young man, and we're excited about what God's going to do with him in the future. And what a blessing. Thank you, Alvin, so much. At this time, I'm going to ask you to stand again. And our organist and pianist are going to play Family of God. We'll play it maybe just one time through or so. And meet and greet, if you can, close to you. And after we do that, we're going to start the next phase of the service. All right, meet and greet quickly. Thank you.
Pastor Kirk and I are working together. You know, some of you had the question. Some of you and I have had the question, how in the world could we work together? We've been doing it for almost 5 years. I love Pastor Kirk. He and April and Amy and I went out and visited with one of the members, or two members in our church last night together, had fellowship, and I enjoyed it very much. We're going to be serving the Lord's Supper this morning, so I want to ask all those who are involved in serving, if you would come up and just be preparing yourselves. I wanted to take a passage of Scripture. Pastor Kirk had a great suggestion, as he always does, and it was that passage in Philippians chapter 1. So I want to invite you to open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 1. I always think it's appropriate when we serve the Lord's Supper that we read the Scriptures and have prayer first. And I just wanted us to start with Philippians chapter 1, and it's verse 26 through 28 that Kirk will be preaching from. I'm starting with verse 12. First Philippians chapter 1, verse 12 says, "But I would you should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel." And we could all say that's an amen. The things that happened unto me. Things that happened that led us to become in communication about a need and the supply that was available. It was the right thing to do. But it says, "So that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places, and many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ even out of envy and strife, and some also out of goodwill. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add afflictions to my bonds, but the other," and this is the special, "of love, knowing that I'm set for the defense of the gospel. The one thing that will hold us all together is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ himself, the inerrant and inspired word of God, and the mission that he gave to us. If we all keep our eyes on Jesus Christ and remain focused and committed to the gospel of Jesus Christ, the great commission that he gave us, that will hold us together. No one will be able to bust us apart, get us discouraged or distracted if we stay focused on Jesus, the word of God, and our mission." So we're here together as one church. It's a wonderful occasion. The one that put us all together took a situation which was trouble, a crisis in the life of Parkway Baptist Church, which is, where are we going to meet? You know, where are we going to meet? And when I heard that from Pastor Kirk, I just said, well, let me talk to our church about it, because there is no way that we should ever allow brothers and sisters to have nowhere to meet when they're trying to do the work of the gospel. Amen? All right. So what we did is I met with Living Hope Baptist Church. Living Hope Baptist Church members, you are awesome. I must say that. You have a loving, kind, generous heart, and you were willing to share, and now we're just one church. It's just awesome. You know, we've been meeting here for 4.5 years. You guys have been here, and we just fell in love with everybody at Parkway, and Parkway, I think, likes most of us.
Amen.
Anyway, God took a crisis in the life, and that doesn't he do that a lot? He takes a crisis in your life or my life to get us to stop doing what we are doing and to move us to be following him and to do something else that he has for us. So the reason we're here to get together and the reason that we can share the Lord's Supper together is because God took a problem and used it to get our attention to realize what he had for us to do together. That's why we can do this together as one. The Bible says in Romans 8:28, I'm not making this up, by the way, it says, "And we know all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are, which are called according to his purpose," who are called according to his purpose. So God put this scripture on my heart, and we're going to be serving the table here in a minute, the cup and the bread. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord, Depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. And here it is. Honor the Lord with thy substance. I said that means everything that we are and everything that we have belongs to Him. If we honor the Lord with our substance and someone has a need, then you accept that person and you welcome them and you help them. That's what you do. They needed a place to meet. They didn't have anywhere to go. So we just said, well, come on over. And here we are. I am so glad. If anybody has a question, let me say it here. I am so glad that we're together serving the same Lord. We started with baptism today. One of the things I love about Pastor Kirk and the members of Parkway is you're on fire for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We should never stop doing that. So we're observing the Lord's Supper. Who can participate together today at the table? Every born-again member in the body of Christ can participate in the Lord's Supper. Those who are in a right relationship with one another as brothers and sisters in the body of Christ can participate. We should do so in a worthy manner. That just means because we're in Christ, He has made us fit and worthy. It's because what He did for us. So when we come to the table, remember the broken body and the blood that was shed for us. He's the one that made us fit and worthy, not us. The bread represents the broken body of Christ. You all know that, don't you? The cup represents the blood that was shed by Jesus Christ. We do this today in remembrance of Jesus Christ. It's not about us. It's about us worshiping our Lord and Savior, what He did for us. So it's a time to remember the body of Christ. It's a time to worship and to love one another. It's a time especially to examine ourselves. Each of us should spend some time now in prayer while the men are preparing to serve the elements. I would encourage you to just quietly take some time in prayer. Examine your own self. If there's something that you need to talk to the Lord about, you just do that between you and the Lord. That's private. And as we do that, these wonderful men are going to prepare to serve the bread and the cup. After the service this morning, on the way out, we will have opportunity and benevolence offering at the doors, and that's what our deacons take up, and they do that in order to help people that are less fortunate than we are. We do that every time we serve the Lord's Supper. So, if you would, take this time to pray, and we'll prepare to serve you. God says, after the same manner also, He took the cup when He had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. The Bible says that for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do shew the Lord's death till he come. Guess what? Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Gentlemen, thank you for helping us this morning and serving each of you. God bless you.
We'll sing the first, second, and the last verse of Amazing Grace.
While he's doing that, I've had a number of people from Parkway ask me, I got a Living Hope envelope. I had a number of people ask me from Living Hope, I got a Parkway envelope. What are we doing? And I just want to share with you, we aren't throwing anything away. We're being good stewards of what we spend money on. And so we're going to use every envelope until they're gone. And you can put them in either one, it doesn't matter. If you say, well, I want to use the Parkway envelope, do that. All right? I want to use the Living Hope, do that. If you say, you don't let it matter, just use the one you got. It's okay. It's not a problem. I wanted to make another thought about before the offering. I want you to understand, as a ministry, we want to move forward. We want to move forward. Now, if everybody's waiting for somebody else to do something, then nobody's going to do it. So if you think, well, man, Parkway's here, they're going to be giving, I can pull back a little bit, that's not, we don't want to do that. Or if Parkway, man, we have a church home, permanent, we're here, we can, and everything's fine, we relax, that's not going to work either. We all need to continue to be faithful stewards of what God has attributed Amen. To us personally. And tithing is the right thing always. It is.
Amen. Amen.
And so we want to be a good steward of what God has imparted to us. And I just want to remind you, let's be faithful givers. Let's do our part for the cause of Christ. Let's honor the Lord with the first fruits of our substance. And I think the Lord will bless that. And by the way, awesome time already today. We could go home right now. And we've already been blessed. Duke,
all right.
If you'll come.
Amen. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you've bestowed on us. We ask that you forgive our failings and We hope that you can be a blessing and a comfort to others. Continue to bless and keep us. May this service and our service be pleasing to you. Take these gifts and offerings, guide in their use, direct us in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And I said to him, I want to hear you preach. So I want you to just hook up your seatbelts right now, because I'm only going to begin the message and he's going to finish it today.
Interesting.
Yeah. We like to hear each other preach. We get along really good. We get along even better when we're just he and I and the Lord together. And I am so thankful for that. We just had a situation. I want to read this scripture. It says in Philippians chapter 1. Would you stand with me for reading God's word? Some spiritual aerobics. Stand together. Father, please speak to us now. I look forward to what you're going to say to your brother Kirk and what you've given to me. And the result of that is we want to glorify you. Father, there was a man in our congregation this morning. He was troubled. He's on my heart right now. He needs Jesus the same as anybody needs Jesus. We love him the same as we love every person that comes into this place. I pray for him, Lord, that you would bring peace upon him, clarity of his mind, and I pray, Lord, that you might help him to find a place where he could worship you in spirit and in truth and have peace. If he needs help, I pray he could find the right help for him. So we just say, Lord, minister to him. And now speak to us. Open our ears to hear the word of God in Jesus' name. Amen. So Philippians chapter 1, verse 15 now, it says, some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife. And that's a shame, isn't it? And some also of goodwill. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds, but the other of love. And that's one of the things I love about Pastor Kirk. He loves the Lord Jesus Christ. He loves you. For some weird reason, he loves me. He's a wonderful, wonderful brother in Christ. It says, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. You may be seated. Paul's letter to the Philippians is a very personal letter. The church had just sent Epaphroditus to Paul in prison. Paul was in prison. Epaphroditus was carrying money from other believers to minister to his needs. And Epaphroditus got sick when he was in Rome, and he almost died while he was there. Then the apostle Paul wrote a letter and gave it to Epaphroditus, who took it back to the church to commend Timothy unto them. You see, even when Paul was in prison, and while other people were thinking about him, he was thinking about them and taking care of them. Verse 18 continues, it says, what then, notwithstanding every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And that's the other thing that we will continue to do here, is to preach the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the way, the life, and the truth. He's the only way unto salvation. For I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. You know, preaching about Jesus Christ in a lost world is the first priority for believers. Some people had a question, if these two churches were meeting together, would we stop doing outreach? No. We must continue to do more outreach. We cannot just sit there and say, okay, what Pastor Kirk said is so wonderful about giving, but the same thing goes with the gospel. Everything the Lord asked us to do, we need to keep doing it and doing more of it until he comes back. And I have joy. I know all of you that share the Lord Jesus Christ, you know who the happiest people in the church are? People who've given up the control of their life to the Lord. People who give faithfully because they love the Lord, and people who witness joyfully to other people the good news of Jesus Christ, that's the happiest people on the face of the earth, those people. They just serve the Lord. What's the verse 20 says? According to my earnest expectation, my hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also, Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. One of my favorite verses in the entire Bible, I used to have a partner who's a pastor at Emmanuel Baptist Church up in Highland, California, and he and I used to meet every week and share scripture memory, and it's this one, Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, Christ, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God, who loved me, and he loves you, and gave himself for me and for you. The third thing that I wanted to say this morning is we live for Jesus Christ and we have a lot of joy. I mentioned it, I'm going to say it again. Philippians is just full of joy. Look at verse 21 through 26. 21 through 26, and then I'm going to hand this over to Brother Kirk in just a moment. 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor, yet what I shall choose I wot not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart, and to be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. And having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy of faith. It is a privilege to be a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I remember one week, Pastor Kirk, I had this two letters I received. Pastors get letters. It's not always hero worship, okay? One letter said, I never preach the gospel. The other one said, I always preach the gospel. And both of them said, we're going to get you fired. If you don't quit, we're going to get you fired. And I went to the deacons and I called a meeting before Sunday service. And I said, what do you want me to do? I got one says, I never preach the gospel. They said, that isn't true. The other one says, I always preach the gospel. And the other said, well, we hope so. You know, and they said, did they sign it? I said, neither one of them signed it. They said, just throw them out. That's what they told me, throw them out. We preach the gospel, and it gives us great joy to preach the love of Jesus Christ, the salvation of Jesus Christ, because that's why what God called us to do. He called you to preach the gospel, he called me to minister the gospel. That's what we do. Anyway, it is my privilege and great honor to introduce to you Pastor Kirk, for you that don't know him. Is there anybody that doesn't know him? Clarence raises his hand. You know who he is. Get what you get up here. I want to hear you preach. You're welcome.
Philippians chapter 1 and verse 27. I've asked Jason to do something for me, and I don't want this part recorded, Jason. My grandfather has double lung cancer, and he's been given a few days to live. So I called him this morning. He said, I'd like to hear you preach one more time. And so he's going to put this on video for my grandfather to hear me preach. So I'm trying not to be emotional. I need to get through it because I'm going to probably have to do the service. And so if you could be praying about that. But he wanted to hear me preach, so this is for him. You guys are just here. No. If you have your Bible, Philippians chapter 1. Thank you, Pastor Rick, and thank you for the beautiful service we've had already. Again, we could go home and be blessed today. And this isn't a normal service. We all realize that, but it's going to be a great service. I want to read you a couple of verses today. In verse 26 of Philippians chapter 1, it says that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you, or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, and that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. I want to ask this morning that we would have this as our mindset for ministry as we continue to move forward as a congregation. We have some great stories about the past. I know that Living Hope has a long storied history of works that they've done for Christ, and the seniors here would love to be appreciated for the effort and the energy and the money that they've given over many years. And I know it, just as a younger person, I'm not too young, but I'm younger still. The pastors are funny. They're either too young or too old. We're never just right. I'm kind of waiting on that. So, at 42 years old, I would still be considered younger. And I would just say that we need to appreciate what many have done before us and sacrifice the effort and energy invested. And I know that as a younger people, I can tell you their point of view also. The youth, the younger, want to be perceived as somewhat educated and have input and have energy and want to have a part also. So it's a both taking two people and, as the scripture says, striving together for this faith of the gospel. Right, everybody? And as we move forward as a church and ministry, we've both had many successes in our work. You say, where are the successes at? Do you have this? Do you have this? No, you're missing out. What in the success of the work of God? And the young man, 10-year-old young man, Alvin, that got baptized, that's a success.
Amen.
I remember when he was born, it was one of the highlight of our church, and our church family, to have a added to the Tabano family, a wonderful family that we all love dearly. It was to see him baptized, that's a success.
Amen.
We had a Sunday children's ministry today. We had 7 children receive Christ today so far that we know of.
Amen.
We had yesterday we had 30 people go out to witness and give the gospel of Christ in our community. Though that's what success is. And I'm excited about what we can do in the future. At this moment, right now, we have a Spanish service that's going on, and they've been averaging close to 70. God is doing a work.
Amen.
The saved and the baptized, the lives that are changed, the church plants, the missions work that we've all invested in. We've all had our share of trials, I would say, as a church. We've each had our own set of trials in our ministries and even in our own lives. So over the next few weeks, we endeavor to have a course of a new milestone in our ministry and our work. So what does this church need to continue to highlight and to continue here in this area? We need to continue together in a few things to keep our church striving together, working together, building together for the faith of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm going to give you 6 points this morning. Some people have said, Parkway Baptist, we've had limited time. You say, Pastor, we've been on an hour time limit, about an hour and 5 minutes or 10 minutes. So I preach about from 25 to 35 minutes. And on a communion day, I would preach about 20 minutes. I've had people say, Pastor, you preach too short. Well, guess what? That's all over. You're in for it now. So you'll be the last one of Polly's today. If you look with me at verse 27, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast. Notice the words, in one spirit, with one mind, striving together. Why? For the faith of the gospel. I'm going to give you 6 points this morning, and we'll be done quickly today. I'm not a long-winded preacher at all. I feel like if you can't get your message across in a certain amount of time, then you need to go back and rethink it. Number 1, how can we strive together? How can we work together? Number 1, through the Word of God. Through the Word of God.
Amen.
The Bible has always been the principal thing in Parkway Baptist Church. I believe, as long as I've been here, the Bible has been the principal thing in Living Hope Baptist Church. And if we're going to continue as we move forward, the principal thing is going to be the Word of God.
Amen.
We enjoy technology. We enjoy the video screen. We enjoy the social media. We enjoy these kinds of things that were enjoyable, they're good. So our ministry will not be based on technology.
Right.
I believe the pastor, Rick Patterson, has a good personality, and he's very good at dealing with people. And I'm okay sometimes, right, if you catch me on the right day. But we are not going to build this ministry on the personality of the pastor. That's not the goal of this work. This goal of the church here is that we have beautiful properties that the Lord has afforded to us all now. Praise the Lord. Thank you, God, for that.
Amen.
We have beautiful buildings here and the beautiful lights and nice things that have been afforded to us. Children's ministry building is beautiful. The adult ministry building next to it, the youth on the second floor, it's unbelievable. Maybe we should have a tour day where we just take tours of the property. I'm serious. The fellowship hall, well, anyway, no, I'm just kidding. It's nice. And the offices are great. And sorry, they're laughing at me. But it's a blessing, and we're thankful for it. It's a wonderful thing. But I'll tell you what, this church is not built because we have nice buildings. The purpose of this church and the ministry and what it's built upon is God's holy word. Amen?
Amen.
The word of God is the foundation, the scriptural principle. I love being a Baptist because I love that we put the authority of scriptures, God's word, forefront and foremost in the work of the ministry.
Amen.
The word of God. Secondly, if you have your Bible, I'd like for you to look with me. I'll just quote it to you. Luke chapter 18 and verse 1. It says, men ought always to pray. One way we can strive together is we have the same Bible, God's Word, to put in the forefront of our life. The second way we're going to strive together is through prayer. Incense in the tabernacle was a picture of the constant prayers before God. All that the church does should be bathed in prayer. Every sermon should be prayed for. I was here this morning in my office, and before I got my message out that I'd already had prepared, and I prayed, I said, Lord, please be with me. Guide me as I preach the message. Holy Spirit, not only speak through me, but speak to the hearts of the people. Work through them. I want every message that's preached from this pulpit bathed in prayer. Every person, every lesson that is given in a Sunday school class should be bathed in prayer. Every song that is sung, Sonia, you picked the perfect song. I'm so thankful for that. Every song that is sung, is sung, it should be bathed in prayer. Every message that is preached, every witness that is given out in our community should be given, but had been bathed in prayer. Every ministry that we have, the bus ministry, the children's ministry, the youth ministry, all the ministries that are afforded us, available to us here today, every ministry should be done as it was bathed in prayer. The transportation that we've given for people should be done. We pray, hey, bus workers and bus drivers, you ought to pray together before you leave in the morning and you go out and do the work of God. As you study, every Bible study should be done. We should be bathed in the work of prayer. Our Bible study on Friday, I don't know about the other ones, I believe they all do, but first thing we do is we don't have a Bible study first. The first thing we do is we take time out before it starts, and we take prayer requests, and we pray together as a Bible study that we want God involved in this Bible study. Amen?
Amen.
It's bathed in prayer. Everything that we do, it should be bathed in prayer. Prayer truly makes the difference in the work of God and in the cause of Christ. A church without prayer is a powerless church.
Amen.
That's why so many churches have to use all these other dynamics to get people to come. We got to have this, and we got to have this, and we got to have this, and we need the strobe light, we need this, we need smoke coming out of the floor, and we need the pastor with a white suit. Hey, I need a white suit. Anyway, I don't know if I can pull it off. But look at, we want God in this place. We don't want to have to manufacture God.
That's right. Amen.
Come on now. Striving together through the Word of God. Striving together through prayer. Thirdly, striving together through trial. By the way, when you pray, pray for some people you don't know. We got a prayer sheet this week that was a little different because we had people on there that we didn't know. How many of you had the same thing happen? Guess what? What a wonderful opportunity. You start praying for those people, and then you'll meet them. You'll say, John, oh, I've been praying for you. I didn't know. Oh, that's so awesome. Right? Striving together through the Word of God. Striving together through prayer. Striving together. Let me tell you this one. Now, the married couples in here know what I'm talking about. Through trials. Trials teach us so many things. They drive us to God many times. Many times a trial is good because it makes me get closer to my God. My wife is down here, and I found a picture yesterday of us when we were just, I think we were 21 years old. I had hair. You would have loved me. I wasn't any taller. I was the same height. But I did have hair. And I found a picture of us together. And I would say that with us together, one of the things that has made us closer is the trials that we've endured together.
That's right.
It made us closer. It made us stronger. And I'll just say this morning as a church, you say, how can we get two congregations to be one and work together for the cause of Christ? I'm going to tell you how to do it. It's not exciting, but we're going to have to go through some trials together. And when you have to stand together through a hardship, it's going to help you. You have to endure some conflict together. We stand hand in hand and arm to arm, and we move together for the cause of Christ, and we endure that affliction, as the Scriptures talks about. Afterward, we'll look back and say, wow, I didn't realize we were so close. Yeah, we're close because we've endured some things together.
Amen.
Through trials. Trials teach us so many things. They drive us closer to God, and many times, actually, a trial drives me back to God.
Amen.
Trials seem to drive us to our knees and encourage us to turn to our brothers and sisters in Christ to engage them and ask them to pray for us. I've had a few people who've gone through great trials, but they didn't want anybody to know about it. I'll just say this. If you don't let people know, we can't pray.
That's right.
The Bible actually teaches us to bear ye one another's burdens. You're holding me back from doing what God asked me to do. Strive together through the Word of God. Strive together through prayer. Strive together through trials, and striving together through godly examples. Through the examples in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 1, it speaks of it. Through the examples of pastors and Sunday school teachers and leaders and church staff and others, God often uses human instruments to develop the faith of others. Although this shouldn't be our greatest source of faith, other people, God's Word should be our greatest source of faith. It should be or could be a part of our faith. When I look to the older generation, I see some men of God who've lived 30, 40, 50 years and been faithful. And it says, hey, as a pastor that's been a pastor for 18 years, I can make it to that 40-year mark. Right?
Yep.
I think Pastor Rick had, was it 57 years? Anniversary, Mrs. 47 years. I'm cutting extra years on you, brother. All right. 47 years. He's been married for 47 years. I can say, hey, I want to be married for 47 years someday, Lord willing, right? So that godly example gives us something to look to. And let me just say, as a church family, we can look to the godly examples in church and say, you know what? We can grow because of that. Striving together through godly examples. And striving together through fellowship. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, it says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. It talks about the church of God coming together. And don't neglect that time of worshiping of God together. We live in a day and age where everything is more important than God and church. You say, Pastor, that's not true. It is true. On the average, the churches are full. I mean, the churches are empty and the stadiums are full on Sunday.
Yeah.
Right. Where throwing a football or shooting a basketball or hitting a hockey puck has become more important and more exciting than God's Word. I'll tell you what, that stuff is going to be gone. Yeah. What the most important thing is God's Word and God's people coming together, forsaking not the assembling of themselves together, excited and ready to fellowship and be ready for God's Word.
Right. Amen.
Christian fellowship is more than, by the way, than just playing a game. Our teenagers, we have youth ministry and youth activities, and they come together and just say something. We don't just have them come together and play games. Everybody plays games. But when they come together, every time, Brother Edward Sullivan, our youth ministry director, he knows that, hey, when you have the youth together, this Bible is to be a part of it. The Bible should be open. The Word of God should be taught. Preaching should be a part of it. And I'm all for having fun. I enjoy it. But God's Word should be a part of every youth ministry and every ministry of the church.
Amen.
Through fellowship. Christian fellowship is more than just playing a game or talking about your week. By the way, it is really talking about what God is doing in your life and not just time together. So when I'm with other Christians fellowshipping, hey, I should be saying, hey, God's doing this for me. What's God doing for you? Hey, I'm struggling with this. What are you struggling with? What can we pray? Can I pray with you about? How can I mentor you? How can I encourage you? How can I strengthen you as you're my brother in Christ? Hey, fellowship in the church is not just a flippant, silly little thing. It's an important part of the work of God.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
Striving together through fellowship. And lastly, and not least, striving together through through serving. If you take your Bible, turn to the book of Galatians chapter 6. Each of us, Pastor Rick and myself, did cut down on some things because we want to be gracious to each other and to the church here. But I want to give you this verse because it's so important. Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 and 10. If you look at it with me, it says, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. I've learned something being a pastor in 18 years. Actually, I've learned a couple of things. But one of the things that I've learned is that often us church folk, believers, Christians, however you want to call it, we are often more patient with the unbeliever than we are with other brothers and sisters in Christ. And I want to challenge you, if you want to say that, or encourage you to learn as a church family to be gracious one toward another. Some of you probably came in today and somebody was in your seat. How many of you, somebody was in your seat today? Well, let me tell you something. That's a blessing, isn't it? Just think, if it was empty in here, you could sit anywhere you wanted. I had somebody, excuse me, years ago, I had somebody say, Pastor Beard, the bus, man, the bus, he picked up these kids on the bus and they messed up this. And I showed them the verse. I said, where no oxen are, the crib is clean. Would you rather have a Sunday school class that's perfect and never gets dirty and everything's in line and no one ever come? Oh, but all these people in the church, what about the wear and the tear? What about this? I said, what's the church here for? Praise the Lord that we have people.
Amen.
That are going to get the church dirty. Amen. But don't get it too dirty. But I mean, you know, there's people here. This is exciting. Hey, the auditorium is almost full. I mean, there's people around. There's kids outside. There's a nursery going on right now. There's two children's ministries going on right now. There's a Spanish church service going on right now. Man, this is exciting to be in the house of God. Let us be gracious to each other. Somebody has your seat. Somebody sings a song different than the way you're used to singing it. Somebody sat your place in the choir. Somebody did this. Well, they did that different. I'm not used to that. They did this different. I'm not used to that. Right? At least it's not an apple pie. Thank you, Jerry. I actually needed that. It is an inside joke. There's nothing like serving alongside someone as you do the work of God. There's nothing like building that team spirit, truly striving and working together. For the last 5 years, Pastor Rick and I have worked together nearly every day in the offices and the buildings. He knows me, the good, the bad, and the ugly of me. And I know him. And we've chosen to work together for the cause of Christ.
Amen.
I believe it can be done. I don't think it's going to be easy. I think we're going to have good days and bad days. I mean that. I think we're going to have up. We're going to be on the mountaintop. Today will be a mountaintop. We're going to have a valley. I'd like to ask you to do something. I would like for you to stay with us. Be patient. Be gracious. And allow us to move forward for the cause of Christ.
Yes, Lord.
Help us. Be a part of it. God has a great plan for us.
That's right.
You just got to hang in there. It's like when April and I got married. I mean, for the first couple, we were happy. I don't think we ever had any bad days. She's like, I don't know about that. Hey, when we first got, we just thought it was going to be, we didn't care about money. We didn't care what kind of house. We lived in a one-bedroom apartment. You know, we had an old car. We were just excited about being married. We were in our own world. We didn't even think about anybody else. We didn't care. People were getting married. They had funerals at the church. They had all kinds of activities in the church. We didn't go to anything. We didn't want to go. We were married and loving it, right? We didn't care about anything else. Look, we're going to, Maybe it's going to be great here. Everything's going to work perfect. Never have a child. I don't know. I'm thinking maybe something could go wrong. But just be patient. As April and I, we love each other more, a lot more than we did when we first got married. And I think that as a ministry and we move forward, it's just going to get better. And I love Tim's, what we say this morning. Better, better by far.
Amen.
I believe it's going to be better.
Amen.
Be patient, love God, be faithful, let the Lord work in your heart. Striving together for the faith of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Somebody has every head bowed and every eye closed at this time as we pray together. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you and we just ask, Lord, that you just do a great work in us. Lord, we know the message has been given. Pastor Rick and myself, we preached. But I pray at this time, Lord, that as you move in the hearts of the people here and the Holy Spirit does work, I pray that some would stay. We're going to commit. We're going to be faithful to this thing, this church. We're going to help strive together for the faith of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I pray, Lord, that some would say, maybe I've never even trusted Christ as my Savior. Today will be the day. What an exciting time that would be. Lord, maybe some are struggling with trials, as we talked about earlier, and trials of the life. I pray that you give them the strength they need. Help us, Lord. We're standing together as a congregation, every head bowed and every eye closed. April's going to play. If God's spoken to your heart in any way, we have our leaders should be here. That would be the same. Living Hope, if you have altar workers, I'm not sure if you do, if you'll come now as we help with people. And if you need anybody to pray with you, we have people that are here in the front that will pray with you this morning. You feel free to come down as God works in your heart. Come down, please, if you will. Every head bowed, every eye closed.
Really good for us with what we heard from Pastor Kirk to be in prayer for his grandfather. His name is Ben Beard.
Lord, we ask that you bless and keep all of us. Make your presence and comfort known to those who are needing it the most. You can guide and direct us in all of the doings. Help us do your blessing to you. Go with us now and help us to apply new truths to been shared by Pastor Rick, Pastor Kirk. Give us understanding and knowledge to apply your direction. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.